and then you can start after that. Okay.
Is that the Moses chart? Well, this the Moses chart. Yeah, I got you.
Yeah, whenever you see the Moses chart, I'm going to be scrolling through here, but when the music stops, you should hear the music.
Uh-huh.
And then you can go ahead and proceed, and Samuel can do the prayer, and Eunice will do the scripture reading. And then I'll let you know.
All right.
I'll let you know in the notes if anybody comes to who's going to be the speaker. Okie dokie.
Okay. All right.
I'm going to start class now.
In this world that I'd rather be. Yahshua's the only one who's worthy. I believe in Yah's love. He has called me His son.
Love.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Hortense Crochet Perfect, and I will be your moderator with this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. At this time, I would like to introduce our dean, Dr. Marland L, and our president, Dr. Sean Hajimwa. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin languages have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus or Jehovah are impossible rendering of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, the limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine vision and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan, and his demon, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation or faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We will now have a prayer by Dr. Sean Hodgenwaddle. We'll have a selection of music, and our scripture lesson will be John, the 14th chapter, and that'll be read by Dr. Eunice Riley.
Good morning. Let us bow in our hearts for a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, We pray that what's spoken from the floor today edifies the body of Yahshua the Messiah, in that whatever is said increases the knowledge and understanding of your great divine purpose, pattern, and plan. We pray that you keep us from all of the distractions that may be going on in our minds about the things that are of the world, and that you take us out of the world to do your will and not our own. We pray that you help us to remain conscious of your ever presence in everything that we do. All these things and more in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
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 Seven times around.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from John, the 14th chapter, page 144. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. John, the 14th chapter. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in Yahweh, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, and I tell you, I must go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whether I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Rabbi, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Yahshua said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him. Philip said unto him, Rabbi, show us the Father, and it suffices us. Yahshua said unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for my very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, He that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If ye love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, which the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. But ye see me. Because I live, ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments, and keepeth them, it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. Judah, not Iscariot, said unto him, Rabbi, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us, and not unto the world? Yahshua answered and said unto him, If a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him, and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my saying, and the words which ye hear is not mine, but the Father which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye love me, ye will rejoice, because I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it comes to pass, ye might believe. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh, and has nothing in common with me, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so I must do. I have read John, the 14th chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Eunice Reiser and Dr. Sean Hodgenwater. Now it is a privilege and an honor to introduce our first speaker, the president of the Ontario branch, Dr. Sean Hodgenwater.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's an honor and a privilege. I'm glad to have the opportunity to stand before you and express some of the things that have been brought to my understanding and the scripture lesson was good. I want to work with the scripture lesson. First, I want to, I'm going to jump around a little bit. Let's start at the 20th verse there, please.
John 14:20.
Mm-hmm. Pick it up at the beginning of let me see, 17. Start at 17.
17. The spirit of truth, which the world cannot receive.
Now, there's a spirit of truth that the world cannot receive. The world being synonymous with age. See, this at this time, Yahshua the Messiah had not completed fulfilling all of those 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. Philip's asking Yahshua to show him the Father, or show them the Father, that it might sufficeth them. Now, he said, Have I been so long with you that you don't know me? When you see me, you see the Father. You see? Now, they're in that third age. And the world cannot receive of the spirit of truth because it has not been poured out yet. So we're reading about this spirit of truth here, which the world cannot receive. Now, continue to read. Why can't it receive it?
Because it seeth him not.
Why can't it see it? Because it cannot see it. It can't receive it because it can't see it. Read.
Neither knoweth him.
Neither does it know anything. Well, we got over in, what is that? Romans, the 10th chapter, the prayer, don't pick it up. Saul's prayer is for Israel, is that they might be saved because they have a zeal of Yahweh, but not according to knowledge. Read.
But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you.
He's talking to his disciples. This is Yahshua the Messiah, the boss in a body, come down, fulfilling the law that he gave to Israel. And he's saying that ye, the disciples, ye know him. He's pointing them out. Since they want to ask him, show us the Father, all right, I'm going to show you.
Yet they still, these words are going over their head at this time. But there's a comforter, and we're going to read about that. It's going to bring these things back to their remembrance. But continue, please.
For he dwelleth with you and
he
shall
dwelleth
be in
with
you.
You. He's standing right in front of them. Read.
And shall be in you.
And shall be in you.
I will not leave you comfortless. Mm-hmm. I will come to you.
Read.
Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more.
Now, the world that can't see him anyways, because they're stuck in the flesh, looking at the carnality of the things. Now, he's going to get hung up here on a cross, on a tree. And they're going to think he dead. He gone. They ain't going to see him no more the way that he is at this time where he's speaking to his disciples. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. Read.
But ye see me.
But ye see me. See, because didn't he resurrect? Read.
Because I live, ye shall live also.
Now, what is that? 1 John 2 and 4, I believe. Yeah, just pick it up. Pick it up 4 and 1. First John 4 and 1, and hold where you're at over there. We're gonna get right back to that.
1 John 4 and 1. Mm-hmm. Beloved, believe not every spirit.
Now we got a spirit of truth that we're talking about, and it's saying believe not every spirit. Read.
But try the spirit whether they are of Yahweh. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world.
Now, there's a spirit of truth, and then there's a spirit where abide false prophets. Now, a false prophecy isn't something that's true. Mm-hmm. So that must be a mystery of iniquity that's being spoken about right there. Continue to read.
Hereby know ye the spirit of Yahweh.
Hereby know ye the spirit of Yahweh, you that are out there in the world that are believing whatever it is that you believe. Dr. Kinley said, you know, there's many different things that you believe. You don't have a choice but to believe some things right when it's presented to you until something better comes along. Mm-hmm. You did. Now, there has been faith. We have a faith that we can use to know the Spirit of Yahweh. Because we have a pattern that is dependable beyond anything that we've ever known to be dependable, reliable. It's just. It's right. We need to know something about this spirit of Yahweh. Read, please. Hereby know ye the spirit of Yahweh.
Every spirit that confesseth that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh.
Every spirit that confesseth that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is what?
Is of Yahweh.
All right. We're going to break that down a little bit. We're talking about the spirit. Give me 1 John 5 and 7, and then we'll get back here. Hold where you at.
1 John 5 and 7.
Yes, please.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one.
This is the unity of the Spirit. Now read.
And there are three that bear witness on earth. The Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one.
Now that is the three that agree in one on the earth. Now, both of these, both have spirit included in them. Now, we want to know something about the spirit of truth. The three that bear witness on earth, you've got the spirit, the water, and the blood. Now, we want to know the spirit of Yahweh. And every spirit that confesseth that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is of Yahweh. Every spirit that confesses that Yahshua, which is patterned by this tabernacle. We read over in John 14 and 6 that Yahshua said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life.
Right.
When you read over in the first chapter of John, the Word was with Yahweh, the Word was Yahweh, and the Word was the light of the world. It gave every man life, every creature that had life. It got it from the Word. Yahshua the Messiah said he is the life. Mm-hmm. When you got on this tabernacle right here, you got first you got your gate, which is the entrance. Then you've got your brazen altar of sin sacrifice, second step, third step. Brazen altar or brazen laver. Fourth step is the door to the holy place where the cup of holy anointing oil is, where you've got the quickening, which denotes spirit. This is the way into the holy place. Out here, you in darkness in the court round about, that is. Now you get to this door. Now you done found the way into the holy place. Where there is light, illumination, or understanding, or knowledge, and you've got substance. You've got the table of shewbread with the 12 loaves for the high and the low priest to eat on while they're officiating. And then you've got the golden altar of the incense that makes intercessor in between the court roundabout and that stench that's on that sacrifice, that altar of sacrifice, and it makes an intercessor between that court roundabout and the most holy place, being a sweet-smelling savor unto Yahweh. Yahweh represented as the cloud that's dwelling on the mercy seat, and you see, there's a cloud that's coming up off of this altar of incense here as well, and it smells good. And only the high priest alone knows the composition of this, the ingredients that goes on this altar here. Now, you come into this gate. You entering in, and you're going to bring, there's going to be an officiation here, right? So you coming into this gate, you coming in with a sacrifice. It better be an acceptable sacrifice. There's only certain things that you can put on this altar here, okay? Then now before it goes on the altar, it's got to get killed. You striking it on the four points. Now we done deemed that it's an acceptable sacrifice. Now it gets killed. Now it goes up here to the second step, to the brazen laver, and it gets washed up, gets prepared and everything to be burnt on this altar offering right here. Now you done washed it up and you cleaned it up, in the low priest or high priest, whoever's got that sacrifice, they got to clean themselves up too, because it's a bloody mess. Now this thing gets set up on this altar with the grates right here, and it gets burnt. Now you got three people working in here. One high priest and two low priests. It's a lot of work. This thing was burning all day and all night long. It was always burning. It was always lit. So somebody got to put coals down here. Somebody got to clean all of the debris from out from the bottom and the ashes and so forth and so on. And while they working, see, they go in order to get into this holy place. While they doing their work out here in the court roundabout, they gotta go through the door. So when they come into their service, they gotta be anointed. They gotta have that quickening to go into that holy place, which is the way. Yahshua said, I'm the way. He said, see, he's the door. That's the fourth step. When we look on the ages and dispensations, you've got the fourth age coming up. What we're talking about here in John, they're in the third age. He's going to usher in the next age, the fourth age, the present kingdom age, the age of grace, where you don't got to do all of these works that they had to do that made sin exceedingly sinful. See, now once you into the, you pass this door, you in the holy place where you got light. See, now this, there's a veil. There's a first compartmental veil right here. And that's kind of opened up. So in the daylight, the sun in the sky shine on right on down in there, and it'd be light in the holy place. Now at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, that seven branch golden lampstand gets lit. So that it's never dark in this holy place.
That's right.
What's that, Doctor? Yeah, in the tabernacle is facing east. So when the sun rises, it's shining in that door, so that there's nice, there's light in there. When the sun comes up in the morning, about 6 a.m., that's about that time, they snuff out that light. But there's always, is it 9 o'clock? Okay, we want to get these things right. But all right, they lit it at 3 and they put it out at 9.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. No, that's the third hour, right? Okay. Because their time is kind of like military time. They go the first, second, third, fourth. They don't got 12 o'clock noon and then 1 o'clock, you know. Yeah, they don't got it like that. But their day starts at 6 a.m. So that's the first hour. So the third hour is 9 a.m. our time. That's when they snuff out that light. All right. And the sun's high enough up so that there's light in this holy place right here for the high priest and the low priest to officiate in. Now, they get hungry while they doing all of this work down here, handling all of these sacrifices of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. That's constantly breaking his law, bringing up, offering up acceptable sacrifices. So they got to have something to eat. That's, you got your 12 loaves of unleavened bread that are placed on the table of shewbread there. See, you got work to do. This is a job that's taking place. This isn't just some guy on a cross. Mm-hmm. You see this, and it's static. It's not doing nothing. He hung up there, ain't moving. Nobody talking about the works that he doing in the church, that is. All of the things that he did before he got up here that caused him to get up here on this cross. They're not talking about all of this officiation that he had to do, going up and down and up and down and up and down, up, you know, because there was only one day of the year that the high priest would go up into the most holy place three times, sprint with blood, sprinkling blood seven times, or every time he went up there for a total of 21 times. That's right. And if he officiated right on that Day of Atonement, there was a flash. That was unto a vision. See, it was unto Yahweh. See, making an atonement for the sins of the Jews or of Israel for the next year. You see, this is a pattern. And we in this school show proof that everything goes according to that pattern. Now, we're talking about Yahshua and Yahshua being the way. Now that's the way you got to go through to get into the holy place. You got to go through this door, the fourth step right there. You see, he's the truth. You see, boy. There are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. Now you got Yahshua being an intercessor between this place. You got a second compartmental veil here that covers up the secret hiding place of Yahweh. See? There's angels embroidered on this second compartmental veil. It's actually, this veil is the second compartmental veil, but it's right here. You see? It's dark in here. There's a cloud that comes up. Yahweh is represented by a cloud. He's not a cloud. But you got a cloud coming up right here off of this altar. Sweet smelling savor unto Yahweh. And you've got this cloud that was a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day to Israel the whole time that they were out here in the wilderness of Sinai after they was given, before and after they was given this tabernacle pattern and told to build it. And they did it. And when this cloud came down and rested on this, the mercy seat here, they stayed. They chilled. They wouldn't have to get up and move. But when this cloud came up off of this mercy seat and moved somewhere else in the wilderness, they packed up their tents. They packed up their camp. They packed up this tabernacle and they moved it to where the cloud rested. And then they sat down. When your conscience tells you to get up and go someplace, don't the rest of your body move? Don't all of your members move around with it? And when you get tired, don't all of this sit down too? That's almost how it goes. Yep. This works the same way. That's why we got this chart. Man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. And you got the tabernacle here. And you've got a man opened up. You can see all his internal organs right here. And then he's broken down according to the principal vessels in this tabernacle. We're made just like this. You read in Genesis that we're made in his likeness and image. See, the world cannot see Yahshua because they don't know him. The Hebrew language. See, we got Jesus. The world thinks that this is Jesus. The Hebrew language, the names in Hebrew, you can hear about this in Oceanside's class. I got to get this, the concepts of the Jews. It's a book like this. It's a Jewish concept book. They were talking about it. Diane and Carl Emler were citing from this book. They were reading out of this book and they were talking about the name of Yahweh and how, and in this book, when they read this excerpt, these Jewish writers, they contradict themselves in many different ways about this name. And they're talking about why you can't pronounce this name of Yahweh. But one of the things that stood out to me about what I'm talking about right now when they were talking about these names in Hebrew is that they express someone's character. The Hebrew names express the character of a person. See, the personality of a person, the works that they do. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So if your name expresses the works that you do, what do we talk about here? Where are we at? Hold where you're at in First John, the fourth chapter. Mm-hmm. Do. Read back in the scripture lesson, the 11th verse.
Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me.
Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Why?
Or else believe me for the very work's sake.
Believe me for the work's sake that he does. See? Because that name Yahshua is expressing the character of the individual. This specially prepared sacrifice. See, when Gabriel appeared to Mary and Joseph, that angel told them that the one that was going to be born would be named Yahshua. Why? Because he would save the world from their sins. Right? Mm-hmm. Let's get it. Let's just get it. Because I just want to hear it right. Because I want to make a point here about this name of Yahshua and how it can't be Jesus. Now, that doesn't mean that I hate you or we hate somebody or we don't like somebody because they are using the name of Jesus. That's not the case. That's not the reason why we stress this so much. The reason why we stress this is because we're talking about the spirit of truth. And the truth is that his name is Yahshua and it's got a meaning. And since it's got a meaning and it's a name above every name, then it's important for you to know it. We want you to come out of the world and come into the light, which is the spirit of truth. Did you get that there in, what is that, Matthew or whatever? He shall save the people from the world from his sins. The reason why I want it read, because I'm not saying it the way it's in the book. He shall be called Yahshua, for he shall save.
Matthew 1:25. And knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Yahshua. You want something else?
No, yeah, that's not. It might be in Luke. Let me see if trusty Google will help me. Save us from our sins. Matthew 1:21.
Matthew 1:21. Mm-hmm. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahshua, for he shall save his people from their sins.
See, that name is important, and that name has a meaning. They shall call his name Yahshua, for he shall save his people from their sins. See, I was saying it wrong, and that's why I really wanted to get it read, because I realized that I was saying he shall save the world from their sins, but the world's not getting saved. The world is cannot see. It cannot receive that spirit of truth. But he shall save his people, the sons, from their sins. Now, I want back over, read John 14:11 again.
Believe me that I am in the Father, mm-hmm. and the Father in me.
Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me. His name has, he come in his Father's name. That's what I wanted. John 5:39, but continue reading that right there, and then get John 5:39.
Or else believe me for the very work's sake.
Read.
Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also.
He that believeth on him, Yahshua the Messiah, the works that Yahshua does, he will do also. What he's saying is that upon receiving the Holy Spirit of truth, we got Jeremiah 31:31. We don't got to get it. Yahweh says, I give you a new law, not according to the law that was given to the fathers when they were brought out of Egypt by a mighty hand. Where this law was written on tables of stone. See, they broke this law, but this new law would be written in your hearts and your minds. See? Now, he that believeth on Yahshua, the works that he did, see, when you receive this Holy Spirit, you're taken prisoner. You don't got no choice but to do the things that of the Spirit. You will mortify the flesh. The things that you want to do, you're just not going to be able to do them anymore. You're going to turn away from those things when you see them. See, when hold John 5:39 right here where it says, oh, come on. 23rd verse.
Which one?
First John 14.
Okay. And 20 what?
23rd.
Okay, 23. Mm-hmm. Yahshua answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him.
If a man love me, he will keep my words. See, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. See, now, in the beginning, Yahweh, pure spirit, inscrutable. See, Yahweh took on shape and form. This is the Word. This is the expression of Yahweh. See, this right here in the beginning, that's the end too.
Right.
That's what we want you to know. This right here is the beginning and it is the end. See? This is the pattern by which the creation came into existence. Everything that came out, therefore, from that is patterned after this. See? Okay. If you love me, what? I got 5 minutes. Give me Exodus 20 and 3.
Exodus 20 and 3.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt have no Elohim before me.
Thou shalt have no Elohim before Yahweh. Read.
Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven idol,
mm-hmm,
or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth
Read.
Beneath, or that is in the water under the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them,
mm-mm,
nor serve them.
Mm-mm.
For I am Yahweh thy Elohim, as am a jealous Elohim.
Very.
Visiting the iniquity of the fathers, mm-hmm, upon the children unto the third and fourth generation
Read.
Of them that hate me.
Read.
And showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments.
These are the ones that he'll show mercy to them that love him and keep his commandments. Now go back over to where you were at in John and give me King James Version, the 23rd verse, and look up the concordance part of love. If a man love me, we want to know what this love is, because a lot of people don't know what love is in the first place. John 14, 23, where it says, if a man love me. We need to know something about some love here.
John.
What does it mean if a man loves you? How are you going to act if you love him? I want you to get that out of that concordance if you got it right there.
Okay.
You're going to have to hit it on monitor, the third. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes, sir. There we go. All right. Now, if you can click on that first. What's the number of the first one?
G25.
No, not G25. That first one that's inside of there.
You want H?
H5689. Now read that real quick, then get H5, if you can write it down or type it into the thing, get H569. We're going to get that, then I'm going to get off the floor because I'll be just about out of time because we want to know. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now read that one right there that we got, G25 first. So that we can, so that we don't, we're not skipping anything. We just like, oh, you just want to pick this and not that type of thing. You know what I mean? We want to get these definitions. We want to get this right. We want to understand something. We want to know something.
Perhaps from much or compare to love in mm-hmm. a social or moral sense.
Perhaps are compared to love in a social or moral sense. So that's very general. But if we click on that, if we get into that that H one, it gives a better.
569.
Yeah, you got it over there?
No, I'm just reading the number.
You might have to type it into. That's the hard part about this concordance is. See, it pops up on my.
What is it,
H1?
5689.
That's not the one that I want anyways. It's this G5368 is the one that I really want.
Oh, that's the Greek one.
Yeah, but
okay.
That 5689, I'll read it. And it's a primitive root to breathe after. That is to love, sensually, dote, lover. That's what H5689. And since we're having a hard time, I got it right here. I'll just read it. G5368 from Strong's. To be a friend of. Fond of an individual or object, that is, have affection for, denoting personal attachment as a matter of sentiment or feeling, while G25 is wider, embracing especially judgment, and, see, it's embracing especially the judgment and the deliberate assent of the will as a matter of principle. Mm-hmm. See? When you see what we reading here, if a man love me, Yahshua the Messiah, right. He's going to keep his principles. The name is expressing his character. His character is Yahweh, is salvation. We know that Yahweh Elohim made man after his likeness and image, and then he patterned him after, see, and that this tabernacle is the pattern of that. Yahshua the Messiah came in, Deuteronomy 6 and 25. This is the point that I'm trying to make here about Yahshua. You see, you're going to love him. A lot of times we get love confused with lust. Because we think that we are loving somebody because we covet in them. We holding on to them. We want to be around them all of the time. We want to be seen with them. You know, we want to buy them things and make them feel good. But when you love Yahweh, you keep his principles. Mm-hmm. You do the works that Yahshua does. See, that's what he said. He said, if you love me, you're going to do my works. I do the Father's works. If you love me, you're going to do my works. In Ephesians 3:15, it says the whole family in heaven and in earth has got one name, and that one name is not Jesus.
Right.
It is Yahshua. Yahshua the Messiah. See? Now, if you Know the spirit of truth. The spirit of truth is the spirit that confesses that Yahshua is come in the flesh. It can only confess that Yahshua is come in the flesh if it can see something. You got something to say? John 17:3. Read that. Go ahead and read that.
17:3?
Yes, please. Okay.
John 17:3.
Read, please.
And this is life eternal.
This is life eternal. Now, in the beginning is the Word, and the Word, man, that Word was the life of the old everything. Now, this is life. This is explaining what that Word is manifest in the world. Read, this is life eternal.
That they might know that.
Now, we got to know something. We read over in John 14:17 that the spirit of truth can't be received by the world because the world can't see them and neither do they know with them. Now, this is life eternal that you might know. Read.
That thou only art the true L.
That Yahweh Elohim is the only true L. That this is the only pattern that you're going to see throughout the entire creation. Mm-hmm. Read.
And
Yahshua the Messiah, who came through the virgin loins of Miriam, who Yahweh Elohim has sent to fulfill the law that was given to the Jews, which is fulfilling the promise that was given to Abraham. That through his seed, all of the families of the earth would be blessed. Because as Dr. Love had said very beautifully in the last class, that when he poured out his Holy Spirit here on Pentecost, see, we didn't go all the way into it, but what happened is he poured out his Spirit on all flesh. All flesh, see? Now, I had quoted over in 2 Corinthians or 1 Corinthians 3:14 about how that second compartmental veil remains when they still preach in this law. But Yahshua done away with it. When you continue reading, it's done away in Yahshua. See, This old boy, he got the blinders on you. And what I was trying to get when I was on the floor, Dr. Aaron Alanese was had brought up was Exodus 23:20, and then I'll have my seat because see what we got to do here. Yahshua, he ended this law right here, ushered in a new covenant in the grace. See, now we've made our way into a new dispensation and a new age right here. Now, this is correlated with the fifth step. You got light, you got bread, you got intercessor here. So you got Yahshua the Messiah making the intercession between you and Yahweh. See, Now, Dr. Kinley came in down at the end of this age, and he had a vision and revelation and then wrote the book, and he preached for almost 45 years. And see, what he did is expose the mystery of iniquity that's on that veil right there. So now that veil can be rent. Death, hell, and the grave can be conquered just in the same way that it was. That veil was rent when Yahshua the Messiah died up there on that cross. See, because you got to die in order to go to heaven. So when your flesh dies, Yahshua will make you alive. And you want that to be done the tenth. Objective of the school is to inherit eternal life now. See, now down here at the end of this age, we can look over. We got that veil's been rent. We can look right on over into immortality. Dr. Kinley said you got 1 foot over into the next age and the other one on a banana peel. You on your way over. See, but we ain't there yet because we still got these conditions. Now, where we at? We reading something.
Exodus 23:20.
Yes, 23:20. See, because when that veil gets rent and we move on. See, when we moving on over here into righteousness, peace, and joy, how's it going to happen? Mm-hmm. Read.
Behold, I sent an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place.
That's Yahshua the Messiah that he sent before them to keep them in the way. Now we over here, now we looking to him for our salvation. He's keeping thee in the way. In the way, he said he's the way, Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Beware of him and obey his voice.
Right.
Provoke him not.
Obey his voice. If you love me, you will do his commandments, right? Read.
For he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him.
Oh, my goodness. It ain't Jesus. Read.
But if thou shalt indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak.
Obedience is better than sacrifice.
Yes, sir.
Please, read.
Then I will be an enemy unto thy enemies and an adversary unto thy adversaries.
An adversary unto thy adversaries. He's going to make an intercession for you. Read.
For my angel shall go before thee.
He's going to go before you. Now, oh, man, Zechariah 3:3-1, and that's going to be my last one, but continue reading right where you're at.
Okay. My angel shall go before thee.
Yes.
And bring thee unto the Amorites, the Hittites, and the Perizzites, and the Canaanites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites.
He's going to bring you.
And I will cut them off.
Into the seventh step. See that promised land. He gonna cut them off. Read.
Thou shalt not bow down to their idols.
You're not gonna bow down to them idols no more.
Nor serve them.
Mm-hmm.
Nor do after their works.
Mm-mm.
But thou shalt utterly overthrow them.
Ooh.
And quick break down their images.
Because quiet. That angel is going to lead you and guide you into doing that. You're not going to do the things that you, theories, concepts, and opinions that you thought you could do before you when you came into this school and you didn't know nothing about the ever presence of Yahweh. You're going to do the will of Yahweh when that angel is guiding you and leading you that Yahweh has sent. See? See, that migratory trek is showing back forth to Yahweh. See? Yahshua the Messiah is doing the same thing. He said in John 5:39, and we didn't get it read, and we don't got to get it read because I'm going to take my seat. But he said that the scriptures that they search, they think they got eternal life, but it's not about them. It's not their life in there. It's Yahshua. You got to come to Yahshua. In order to get to the Father, you got to go through Yahshua. Ain't no other way. You got to go through Yahshua. Okay? Is there more there in Exodus?
And ye shall serve Yahweh, your Elohim.
You're going to serve Yahweh. If you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. Read.
And he shall bless thy bread and thy water.
Ooh.
And I will take sickness away from the midst of thee.
And going to take the sickness. He's going to heal your infirmities. Isn't that what it says over there in Romans, the 8th chapter, when it says that that Holy Spirit makes intercession for the infirmities of us through groanings that cannot be uttered? That's
right.
What it says, ain't it?
Right.
Okay. So is there anything else there? No.
There shall nothing cast their youngs nor be barren in thy land. The number of days I will fulfill.
Be fruitful and multiply. Yeah. See, every time you officiate in that tabernacle, you're going to get the flash of the Zekinah. You're going to hit completion. But that mystery of iniquity, he can't get up past that that sixth step right there. He's not getting up. He's not going back. Okay? Zechariah, yeah. And then I'm done.
Zechariah, what?
Yeah, we want you to see this. We want you to see what's happening when you go before Yahweh right here. Read.
Chapter in Zechariah.
Three.
Three.
And one.
Three and one.
Yeah. And because, see, this is a pattern, and this pattern's got to be completed. That old boy, the devil, he's one step short of perfection. He going to keep you spinning. Read.
Zechariah 3:1. And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of Yahweh.
Oh, that Joshua, the son of Nun, the high priest, he's standing before the angel of Yahweh.
And Satan standing at his right hand.
Right at his right hand, right here.
To accuse
What's he doing?
Him. To accuse him.
He's accusing him. In the King James Version, what's it say? I'm gonna make this real clear. Go ahead, read that.
And he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him.
Now we got Joshua right here making intercession. Right? And we're talking about the steps in this pattern. Now, we got that altar of incense right here, just making that intercession between the most holy place, and we know Yahshua is our intercessor. And then you got this veil right here. It's resisting.
Okay.
It's resisting. Yahshua. That boy is resisting him. He sealed what you got over in Ezekiel, the 28th chapter. He sealeth up the sum of wisdom, that old boy, the devil. So that's what we want. We want you to have a knowledge of Yahshua according to the pattern. Everything that you do, look at this pattern. Is it an acceptable sacrifice that you offering up, or do you need to get out that gate? Then leave that. Don't be coming up in here with no unacceptable sacrifice. I hope that you can understand what I'm saying here, because it's important. All praises be to Yahweh our Elohim through his only begotten son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Sean Hodgewaddle. And now it is a pleasure to call on our second speaker, the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marland Love.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
Good to be here. I appreciated the remarks of the first speaker. It's always a, how should I say, a struggle in order to bring about or bring across a thought from one understanding or assumption, really, into another understanding and a factual reality, because I said people have a thought that their Lord and Savior is Jesus Christ. That's what they would say, and that's what they would believe. And us in this school, in this organization, and this is not a religion, meaning we're not doing any traditional ceremonies, having any traditions, meaning the songs we play them for the hearts and minds of the people in order to hopefully get them settled. We don't have to play a song. We don't have to read a scripture reading, although we do that on a regular, repetitive basis. You follow? But it's not a demand that we have to do anything of that nature. We don't have to come here in this building and give a class. You follow? It's not sanctioned or tradition that we do that. You follow? These 10 aims are not 10 commandments whereby we're following. You follow? So it's not a tradition or custom by which this school is predicated on. And as the previous speaker strived in earnest to get one to comprehend about who Yahshua the Messiah is. That's what this whole school is about, is for us to convey the message about one Yahshua the Messiah. Now, we understand that the whole world is calling this one individual that hung on this cross some 2,000 years ago, Jesus. You follow? And as the previous speaker made mention, that many people believe that he hung on this cross, believe that he was buried, believe that he resurrected, and they believe that he went up into the sky as expressed there in Acts, the first chapter. And they got him stuck up there.
Right.
This is where we're saying that there's a contention about the matter. You had read 1 John 4. Yeah, I think so. Let's grab that right back quick again. Because it was very good in what we're expressing. Now, again, the whole world has this erroneous name and title, Christ. They have an improperly substituted title for Elohim, as God, and they have a title as a name for the Father, which is Yahweh. Now, they would call the Pope Father. Yahshua Messiah said, call no man Father. You see, that's not sent from Yahweh. But yet the Pope likened himself to a father, likened himself to the Jesus, what they call him, the vicar is a word of the vicar, but the substitute or the person in place now, since Yahshua's left or Jesus left, in their mind that he's the representative on earth for mankind. I'm just trying to put this out, and I realize not everybody in every denomination acknowledges this fact. But see, you have to acknowledge the fact that all or most all denominations stem from out of that harlot of Catholicism, mm-hmm. is what I'm expressing. Now, however else they wanted to divvy up, because you have the Protestants, the Lutherans, then they'll make their own way about their own denomination. Those are those satanic spirits in bodies that the previous speaker talked about, of the righteousness of Yahweh and the unrighteousness of Yahweh. See, they have the unrighteousness of Yahweh. The Protestants, they still broke off from Catholicism. Mm-hmm. You follow?
All right.
They made their own way. They use the same Bible, and they still calling them Jesus. Mm-hmm. Ain't studied a lick, ain't figured nothing out until this day. So they're all harlots, or dogs, in other words. They don't know nothing about the reality of what this name means, or what this title represents, and what this name means. You follow? And so we're trying to convey a message the way that the founder of this school gave it to us. You follow? Now, he gave Moses a vision when he was 80 years old. You follow? He had Moses come down into Egypt, and he brought his son up out of Egypt. And at an appointed time on June 6, Yahweh spoke to the people. And at an appointed time, Yahweh had Moses come up alone and by himself, and he had him see this threefold intangible sanctuary. And from this sanctuary, he had this vision drawn out about the world and how it was created in 6 solar days. He then subsequently came down as a type and a shadow. He broke the Ten Commandment law because of the unruly nature of that satanic nature of the people that those 606 and 6 Satan, how should I say, those Egyptians that were following the children of Israel, and he was when Pharaoh and his souls, thank you, were following out Moses and the children of Israel, or the son of Yahweh. Pharaoh and his host represented Satan. And when they were drowned in this sea, Red Sea, after they were in pursuit of the Egyptians, you see, that satanic spirit got into the bodies of those that came across the children of Israel. This is what the previous speaker is speaking of, you follow, in the types and shadows that we've been given. And so when Moses came down and saw that satanic nature, or that unequal nature, or the iniquitous nature in the people because they were whoring after an idol. Mm-hmm. You follow? See, this is an idol that people worship to even until this day in the form of Jesus, which is erroneous, which is incorrect. Mm-hmm. You follow? But they have their hearts and desires set on that, just as it was depicted that they made this golden calf out of the things that they brought from Egypt.
That's right.
So we're all duped from the get-go. And we're all coming out of Egypt into a psychological understanding about Yahweh. See, our treasures are those treasures of thoughts that we've incurred until coming into this gospel. And when we come into this gospel, there has to be a change.
Right.
And this story of this migratory pattern is depicting that change. And what it's saying is that this covenant or this tables of stone represented the first covenant. You follow? That's the first thoughts that you receive when you before you came into a knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah or Yahweh or a teaching that will eradicate and bring you unto subjection, bring you unto the love of Yahweh, as this previous speaker is talking about. Right. They don't love Yahweh. You can't love Yahweh unless you know Yahweh. Right. By his son, Yahshua Messiah, we had John 17:3 read, which life eternal is to know Yahshua. You can't come unto Yahweh unless you come by the way of the son. You follow? And what I'm telling you is that that son was set up working with Moses back here during the time of the Egyptians, during the time of the Israelites when they came up from out of Egypt. That's our pattern. This is how we're getting to know and love Yahshua the Messiah. Because see, Yahshua is down here in Egypt. Because why? Because he saw the cries of the people. You follow? They didn't know. They were in bondage. And we have to submit ourselves that we're in bondage if we don't know. We don't have liberty until we come into the presence of Yahshua the Messiah. Into the ears and our sight is on Yahshua the Messiah, whereby in him we live, move, and have our being. You got there in 1 John? Right quick. Yes.
1 John 4:1.
Uh-huh.
Beloved, believe not every spirit.
See, if you got that beloved, if you looked at that and you see the beloved, that the previous speaker, we tried to find it, it bounces you back over to Jeremiah. But we're not going to do all of that. We'll catch it another time. But keep going, the beloved.
But try the spirit, whether they are Yahweh, because many false prophets are gone out into the world.
That's what we're expressing. The many false prophets, we have it depicted on this apostate church. You follow? You have the Latter-day Saints. You have sex creeds and cults. Vain philosophers, psychics, Babylonian and Christendom, Wicca, whatever you want to name it, those are false prophets and deceivers. They are denominations and they are against the Messiah, meaning anti-Messiah. You follow? And the man is the preachers and they're skeptics and atheists and agnostics, infidels and false teachers, false science, theoretical opinions, religious merchants, Satan's ministers. You follow all that? And what we're saying is it comes from out of that Catholic faith. You follow? In whichever way you want to package it up, you follow? It's untrue. Right. It's unholy. You follow? But it was set up that way because of the mystery that Yahweh had purposed in a vision. Mm-hmm. He had one of righteousness and one of unrighteousness. Now, I just said that we've all come in dead on arrival, cloaked, covered, naive, ignorant of the truth of Yahweh. These children of Israel didn't know the name of Yahweh when Moses came down and told them about Yahweh. Because Moses didn't even know at this burning bush, because you read Exodus the 3rd chapter, which is the beginning of everyone's Bible, it says down there on the 12th, 13th verse, Moses asked Elohim, what name shall I tell the children of Israel? He didn't say tell Pharaoh. He said tell the children of Israel. What name am I going to call this Elohim? And Yahweh, or Elohim, begins to tell him by the name of Yahweh. So that lets you know, just like you know, you didn't know the name of Yahweh and the importance of Yahweh, just as the children of Israel didn't know the name and the importance of Yahweh. You follow? Now, we understand that they came up out of Egypt, and then they had a 50-day journey to the base of this mountain where they were supposed to clean up and be ready in order to hear the oracles of Yahweh. Now, they were afraid of Yahweh at that time. Moses was even afraid of Yahweh at this first trip. You follow? Now, all they heard was the name of Yahweh. They ain't worked with nobody. They didn't even know who Yahshua was down there at the time.
Right.
Yeah. They didn't know nothing. And when Moses went away of that second trip for 40 days, They thought he was sure as dead. Sure as dead. Because, hey, there was this fiery cloud set on this mount. And it roared. Just as Yahweh roared down that first covenant to them. You follow? And they say, all that Yahweh say, we will do. Just like we say, we think we're going to do something. Or I'm going to stop drinking. Or I'm going to stop this. Or I'm going to stop worrying about this person. And yet that person, every time his name will come across your consciousness, you're all torn up about it. Because you can't get away from it. That's that Yahweh telling you not to worry about it, but you inevitably fall back into that trap. That's what they heard Yahweh say. All that you say, we will do. And at first, and the one he said was, don't take the Yahweh's name in vain. And all the other 10 that was cast down to them at that time. And what I'm expressing is that when Moses came down this second trip, and he saw that, and they had taken and did not do what Yahweh had told them to do. That's that ignorance. That's that satanic. And they promised to do. Yeah. They promises ain't worth a hill of beans to Yahweh. Because this is a pattern that we're looking at. And we got to see ourselves on this pattern. And we got to see that you ain't got a love or a promise unto Yahweh you can make on your own.
That's right.
You follow?
That's right.
Talking about having the love for Yahweh by way of Yahshua the Messiah. You see? And when you love Yahshua, you love the story by which he's set up, and you see yourself as this stiff-necked, hard-headed people, see, you might have a little bit of humbleness in your heart and in your mind. We talked about having an open heart and having an open mind on Thursday, you see? And see, they couldn't have that. There was nothing in them for them to be able to do that. You follow? Mm-hmm. But that's the nature of man. These are those Catholics, these are those Latter-day Saints, these are those Jehovah's Witnesses going about to establish their own righteousness. You follow? Ain't got a word of Yahweh in their lips, no how, nowhere. You follow? But now, when Moses came up to this mount the third time, you follow? And it was given to him the oracles of the understanding and recapitulation of this first 7 days, and then the subsequent 33 days from the fall of Adam, as the previous speaker talked about, Adam was not being deceived, and that bride or that woman being deceived, you follow? And then that death that fell upon all mankind all the way down until Yahshua Messiah's death, you follow? His burial and his resurrection, you follow? That's that death of the woman or the mankind or the mankind on earth that this whole thing is predicated by. And they weren't going to be able to know nothing about love until Pentecost. You follow? Why? Because as Dr. Samuel Salas said last Thursday, it was the understanding. It was the understanding of what the love, what the faith, what the substance was that we now in this fourth age was going to be able to obtain, which is the report about one Yahshua the Messiah, whereby your heart can be changed and seek Yahweh while he yet might be found. See, and you grow in love. You just don't fall. Yeah, I understand that people say, oh, love by first sight and all the romanticisms and stuff and whatnot. But see, we're not dealing with that. Right. We're dealing with that love of the true gospel, of the true spirit, that was in operation since the very beginning. Right. And then in order to know him as he really is and actually exists, you must believe this. Keep reading.
4 and 2.
You must believe this. Read.
Hereby.
Remember, this is John. This John writing this, 1 John. You follow? He, being the youngest of the 12 apostles, you follow, was the beloved John. Oh, the beloved John. See, he had some love because, you see, when he was laying on his master's bosom here, he loved him. in order for us to believe this.
Hereby know ye the Spirit of Yahweh.
Know ye the Spirit of Yahweh, read.
Every spirit that confesseth that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is of Yahweh.
So you have to believe that. And how'd he come? He not coming as a man. He coming as spirit. And that spirit is in you. You follow? He's not up in the sky.
That's right.
That's a story that they put together to make you believe something that's not true. And when you can hear and feel, you get goosebumps sometimes because some things at times resonate. And you're like, oh my God, that feels so wonderful. It's just like it's right. That spirit acknowledging, giving you a witness to something.
Right.
When you see an aha moment, as it often was when people see this point, when we read over here at Exodus 24th chapter, and we're talking about Yahshua and his minister, Yahshua, went up. See, that's a great mystery. That gives one goosebumps if you understand the significance of that tidbit of information. When you understand that this burning bush was the first place where the name of Yahweh was manifested to a man. That ought to be stimulating to your conscience. You follow? Of knowing that this was the beginning. And that one, Yahshua the Messiah, was down here astral projecting and showing Moses what he's going to do. You follow? Moses didn't turn off and go back to the flock of sheep and back to Jethro's house and say, man, yeah. Jethro, I done seen some stuff. I'm not dealing with that no more. You know, because the Yahweh moved him.
That's right.
Moses didn't believe. He would just moved him, huh? Yeah, it was a mirage in the desert, thinking it was just some old coincidence. Like we often think some things are just coincidental. So there's no thing coincidental in Yahweh's purpose. If you take, I know there'll be a lot of stuff. And sometimes you get tired in your mind and say, Yahweh, you're too much. You don't know what really belonged to where, what belonged to what. Well, that's because we still yet abide in this darkness. Until you begin to look and move by the Holy Spirit. Because that's what that second covenant is. See? Jeremiah talking about it's going to be written in the heart and mind of man. And you're going to be moved just as they were moved, the prophets were moved to write by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. That's why you don't see me come up with no paper, no prescriptive sermon. You might bring a magazine or something and demonstrate something in order to pull out a principle in order to hopefully get you to get a person to comprehend what we're expressing about this invisible L that abided in this body and resurrected a quickening spirit. Where's the quickening spirit for? For your soul.
Right.
So that you may believe what 1 John is saying here. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
3. And every spirit that confesseth not that Yahshua the Messiah is come in the flesh is not of Yahweh.
But what is it?
And this is the spirit of anti-Messiah.
The anti-Messiah. I see anti-Messiah down here. On anti-Messiah. Zoom in.
Right.
See? If you don't believe that Yahshua Messiah is here now, dwelling in the hearts and mind of those who preach the gospel of Yahshua Messiah, you're an anti-Messiah. The book just says so. Because you wound him up here in the sky with his daddy and not believe in the true gospel. That we're letting you know that his name's not Jesus. And you can't get anywhere with Jesus because it's empty. It's vain and it's erroneous. Look up erroneous for me. How are you going to get anything out of something that's erroneous? The book just said it. If you don't believe that he is come, then you are of the anti-Messiah.
That's right.
That's because you don't believe in the Messiah. They did come. You're still waiting. And what we're trying to do as a school is to demonstrate to you and to those who believe not the gospel and believe not that you have a lot to learn, even if you believe he's come. I'll just say that little tidbit too. But keep reading erroneous.
Erroneous from Merriam-Webster Online. There's two definitions. The first one is an adjective It's containing or characterized by error.
Oh, characterized by error. So you believe in Jesus, but you're going to believe in an error. Read.
Mistaken.
Mistaken.
The second definition is archaic.
Oh, this is the archaic one. This is the old one. Read.
Wandering.
Oh, wandering. Read.
That's it. Erroneously is an adverb. And then we've got synonyms. False.
False.
Incorrect.
Incorrect.
Invalid.
Invalid.
Unsound.
Unsound.
Untruthful.
Untruthful.
Inaccurate.
Inaccurate.
Inexact.
Inexact.
Off.
Off.
Untrue.
Untrue.
Wrong.
Wrong. This is what this is. Those are synonyms to express an erroneous name of Jesus. Because the story is that Jesus went away. That's the story. He went away. He's up there on the right hand of God, waiting for us to fix stuff. That's the story that I've been told by the Christian denominations. We got to do right. We got to follow them. They don't believe in Moses, because that's the old God that Moses was believing in. You know, the story is it's just a mishmash. Because they don't want to accept the fact that Yahshua Messiah was back here. Setting up and instituting everything that we have here.
Right.
You follow? Mm-hmm. And so much so that this Ten Commandment law that was given to the children of Israel, which I just showed you, that they promised, Exodus 24th chapter, start at 1. They promised all that Yahweh said, will we do? And they were aware of the name. That's why I just said, when we're reading John here, 4 and about 3, 4th verse, and you believe that, okay, Yahweh not up in the sky, but he is here. There's something more to that, too. And we'll touch on that towards the very end, because there's a lot to that. But keep reading.
Exodus 24 mm-hmm. and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto Moses, mm-hmm. come up unto Yahweh, thou mm-hmm. and Aaron, Nadab and mm-hmm. Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
Yes.
But they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him.
These people right here, when you're talking about these people, read.
And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh and all the judgments.
Now look at people, Moses came to all these people. Mm-hmm. Read.
And all the people answered with one voice.
With one voice and one accord. That means the whole world. Because this is what Israel represented. They represented the whole known world at that time because Yahweh's working with them. Just like here today. Yahweh is working with the sons of Yahweh. He's not giving a lily lick of beans about those antichrists. He said him so.
Right.
Just like he said Lucifer so in the spirit realm for him to do his work. You follow? And to play his trumpet and to deceive those who were supposed to be deceived, which was that representative of that one third. You follow? Mm-hmm. That was cast out. And that casting out, meaning that for the first 4,000 years, Lucifer had that full reign of that. See, the snake represents Satan. Mm-hmm. And you got Adam all the way here to Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. Right. That's what he had. That's what Satan had, his full reign. See, after that, you still have to come in under the understanding of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're just doing some. How should we say, portion or fabricated tradition, custom, or sacrifice according to some old state and condition. You're picking and choosing from, you got a question?
It was the scripture that says, ye will not come to me that ye might have life.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're doing when you don't
right.
go to Yahshua.
You don't go to Yahshua. Yeah. You stuck on whatever you think is correct. Mm-hmm. Because we made a point that we're all coming under this cloak of darkness. That's not the bad thing. The bad thing is not having an open heart and an open mind in order to receive the truth. Mm-hmm. Now, you can't say, well, how do you know? How do you all? Because that's what I often get. How you all know the truth? What makes you all a ragtag group think you know anything about this stellar universe? You follow? And everything that there is. You know all answers. That's not what we're saying. That's not what we're saying. No, you're only going to put me on Jeopardy and think I'm going to win. I'm not going to win on Jeopardy.
Yeah.
Wheel of Fortune or any such thing. I'm not looking to win on that. But what I do look to win is that, hey, I understand where my Father dwells. You follow? I understand what spirit is. Mm-hmm. You follow? And what I understand is that these divine attributes, and there's many more, many, many more, but these divine attributes, you can't perceive them. That's why you don't know. That's the part you don't know. But in what you think you do know, you see, these attributes have taken on form, a shape and form, whereby you can perceive what love might be, as the previous speaker said. You know, you think giving roses and candy and dressing up and smelling good is a sign of love for another person. That's not it. It's a type and a shadow. That's erroneous. It's false. It's not correct. It's untrue. Because you know darn well there's a lot of divorced people out here. They thought they had love. And remember back here that Lord, you're not supposed to divorce.
Yeah.
And you know that thing, they didn't kick all that to the bucket. They giving and sharing in marriage. It's like the days of Noah damn near now. Huh? So what you thought was love, and you're gonna get married under the guise of God up above, you were already wrong. And what we're letting you know is you don't know. And what I do know, I know the guy not up there. I know you can't give me love unless you preach the gospel of Yahshua. And if you don't know his name, you don't know love. And therefore, you don't know. And I'm telling you that this spirit came into a physical body known as Yahshua the Messiah, which you don't know because you know him as Jesus. Now, you got a problem telling me that I don't know. I know that's all I need to know. Keep reading there, John.
Oh, John.
See, that's a little bit, because remember that this Elohim, he came in part, not in totality, so I ain't got to know all the damn answers. All I got to know is Yahshua the Messiah and what his purpose was and what his mission was, and know that I'm a son of Yahweh, and I can preach the gospel to anybody. And not be afraid. Huh? Love is as strong as death, if you like. But see, you got to have that love in you in order to go and preach the gospel. And not be mealy-mouthed about it like I once was when I first came. We got it on recording. Joe Williams said we don't come up here mealy-mouthing. Nay, saying. Told me that, and when I had to sit down, and I didn't know. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. And this is that spirit of anti-Messiah, whereof ye have heard that it should come.
Yes.
And even now already is it in the world.
And that's when you say, well, who tells the truth? That's where that statement comes. The anti-Messiah is here. He's expressing it here. And this is what people say. Who knows the truth? It's all anti-Messiah. And then when one come, you can't discern from a hole in the wall. Keep reading.
For ye are of Yahweh, little children, and have overcome it, because greater is he that is in you than that which is in the world.
Where is he at? You. In you. And so when people want to come and try to correct one, they got to know we're dealing with spirit. And that spirit ain't up above the skies.
Right.
He's dwelling in us. Right? Because he wants us, his children, to know who he is. You follow? See, people worrying about getting things and having things, and that's not the get down with this school. This is not a, what they call, prosperity teaching.
Right.
This is not called prosperity teaching.
Right.
And what's has been expressed, and Sean expressed it before, that when he came into the school, it seemed like things had gotten a little bit harder. Mm-hmm. It was a little bit more of a struggle. Seemed like the pressure of Yahweh put that thumb and tighten the screws down. But see, if you can bear that a little bit and know you're not coming for self-righteousness or self-vain gain, then Yahweh will release that. And he'll open up the floodgates, you see, of heaven in order to learn and know about him as he really is and actually exists. You follow? Because this is Yahweh too in a body.
Right.
You follow? Keep reading.
5. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them.
See, the whole world heareth this. Yahshua the Messiah says over there in John 5. See? John 5, and hold that right there, because they're in the world. And this is why we have this school, that Yahweh set this school up. So that there'll be some way and some means to get those who may be in the gospel or in the body of Yahshua Messiah to know something about the truth.
Right.
You follow? Because Yahweh knew that it was going to be hell to get a person to perceive who he is. Because he had to come down into hell because he's down here.
Yeah.
In order to draw those who might be saved out of the ashes. That's over there in Jude. But nevertheless, when we got Yahshua the Messiah talking, 5th chapter of John, right around the 43, I want to talk about that name, that they're going to have many names. Uh-huh.
43, I am come in my Father's name.
Now Yahshua said, I come in my Father's name. And his name is Yahweh, because the masculine portion of Yahweh is masculine. You follow? And the feminine portion of Yahweh is way, is feminine. So he don't need no external goddess or any subsequent being in order to procreate or to create the creation, because Yahweh's spirit. And he broke himself down in part, not in totality, as Elohim, which is the word or son.
Right.
You follow? Then in John 1:1 and then 1:14, it says that this word, you follow, became flesh. And in his fleshly state, in the flesh came in the likeness of sinful flesh as a form of Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Now, it's Yahshua here saying that he come in his Father's name. Mm-hmm. What's he say?
And ye receive me not.
And they don't believe in the name of Yahshua. But what did he say?
Let another come in
his own name.
Him you will receive.
You got Jesus all over the world. They believe in it. There's no J in Hebrew, Greek, or Latin.
Right.
It's only in Hebrew. You follow? You see, this day here, it ain't but some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. They even came into existence from the letter I.
That's
why we talked about this I in our eye. And let me bring this up right quick, too, from Wednesday. This was Yahshua. Mm-hmm. It wasn't Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
It was Yahshua of Nazareth, Rex of the Jerusalem. I have it up there on the tab to the left. I looked it up. It should be the Wikipedia. Yeah, it shows the spelling of Jerusalem. It was Jerusalem. You follow? You Wikipedia. Nonetheless, we talked about this I and our I yesterday.
Right.
This was a newer version. Pontius Pilate didn't just write I and our I is what I'm saying.
Right.
Pontius Pilate wrote Yahshua of Nazareth,
Rex
of the Jews. This was downsized, I don't know. But this wasn't all that they had just wrote on that chart. You follow? When he wrote it in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin.
Uh-huh.
That's what I wanted to make clear.
Yeah.
You follow? Now, you're reading
5,
John 5.
23?
Yeah.
Okay. I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not.
Yep.
Let another come in his own name. Him you will receive.
Jesus, Allah, Muhammad, whatever other erroneous names that people want to believe, they're going to believe in that name.
Right.
But go ahead and read.
How can ye believe which receive honor one of another?
Because that's what we're talking about. Honor, I got this. I'm going to do. That's what they did down here, the children of Israel, when they worshiped that golden calf, seeking honor one from another. Mm-hmm. Because Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, they were supposed to have stayed on this plateau.
That's right.
Huh? But yeah, they go back down here trying to regulate something. Hey, well, the people, they wanted this. You know, her, it would be, if you had that question, you stayed up here. But because of the purpose of Yahweh, he made them come down.
Right.
He made them so we, the sons of Yahshua, can see that principle that we must come down.
Right.
You follow? Mm-hmm. And we must ascribe and eat all of the things that we've built up in our consciousness, like they had to eat this golden calf. You follow? And become subject to the law or the spirit law of Yahweh. Now, in this age, you follow? Because this is the age of grace.
All right.
You follow? This is the grace that Yahweh has put on mankind that they might learn of him. You follow? And when they learn of him, then they'll have liberty. But they're not going to do that because, read. Mm-hmm.
And seek not the honor that cometh from Elohim only.
See, they're not going to want to seek the honor that comes from Elohim only. Mm-hmm. Don't look at love and look to me. Don't look to love to look to your child or the beautiful flowers or what the beautiful things that the creation produces. That's temporal. Mm-hmm. But look to Elohim. Mm-hmm. Read.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Don't think that. Why?
There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust.
But a lot of people don't even get down with Moses no more because he worshiped that old God of the Hebrews.
That's right.
That was old wives' fables. That's old tales that we don't need Moses no more. Oh, why are we doing blood, water, spirit, for it? Why are we beginning at Moses again? We're tired of Moses. It's still relevant. He's telling them back then, but it's still relevant in often ways, many ways now. But nonetheless, keep reading.
For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me.
Uh-huh, why?
For he wrote of me.
Moses wrote of Jesus. You can't find Jesus nowhere in the Old Testament.
That's right.
No, sir. No, sir. But they're gonna tell you Jesus is your Lord and Savior. That's the anti-Messiah. That's erroneous. And all the other synonyms that we just read, letting you know that that's untrue.
Right.
Because what? He said Moses wrote of him. And him name is Yahshua.
Right.
Yahweh tell Moses, rehearse what you write in Yahshua's ear. Down here in Egypt, Moses says, stand still and see Yahshua.
Right.
Moses up here died in Nebo and Yahshua take over. Mm-hmm. And Yahshua led him over the sea. See, these are the things you have to be first believe. This is your first love. It's the gospel. Then you can love yourself. As the Jews had to receive the gospel first, then to Samaria, and then to the other parts of the world. See, you can't do this. You can't use this on nobody if you don't love Yahweh. You don't know what to say because it ought to be the Holy Spirit in you directing you with whomever you're dealing with. And if it's your friend, your lover, your whatever, they may not be cutting the mustard. And you're going to have to die to that. Mm-hmm. This ain't a personal thing to Yahweh. He's not a respecter of persons. You realize that? He don't give a rat's ass about the flesh. He said, Elohim. Anything else there?
But if ye believe not his writings,
yes.
How shall ye believe my word?
How are you going to believe anything in the New Testament, basically, is what he's saying? You're not going to be able to. It'd be an impossibility. But we're here in this school to help those to see Yahshua the Messiah. I want Jude, the 25th chapter, 25th verse. I want in the King James Version. I think it's Charter 24, catch the continuity. And I'll be done. This is what we do here. This is our purpose for mankind. We don't hate people. We hate the doctrine, as we just talked about, the doctrine of the anti-Messiah. You follow? All of the denominations that strive to tell somebody about the Lord and Savior, and there's erroneous, that's what we have a hate for. And see, and when you believe in any of those things, you're in ashes. You're in darkness. You follow? And you're going to be burned up and consumed in that state of ignorance. But this is what we strive to do. Read.
Now unto him that is able to keep
you. No, I need to go up.
Up, oh, okay.
Keep yourself fire, ashes. But it goes, start at 17.
All right. But, beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before the apostles of our Elohim, Yahshua the Messiah, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time who should walk after their own lusts. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the spirit.
Anti-Messiah, read.
But ye, beloved,
yes,
building up yourselves on your most holy faith.
See, building up your understanding of Yahshua, because he's the faith. Not your faith, but the faith of Yahshua. That's what he's saying you're building it on. People want to get the idea that I have faith, I have faith. No, you only got the faith of Yahshua. That's what you're going to build your most holy faith upon. Because he said life eternal is to know him. Keep reading.
Praying in the Holy Spirit.
Can you pray in the Holy Spirit? Not for things. You pray in the Holy Spirit for what? Read.
Keep yourselves in the love of Elohim.
In that love. That the love that the previous speaker was talking about. That's the love you want to be in order to be able to relish out and just give out. You follow? But keep reading.
Looking for the mercy yes. of Yahshua the Messiah.
See, it's the mercy of Elohim or of Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Unto eternal life.
Yes.
And some have compassion.
Yeah, see.
Making a difference.
This is the compassion that we hold once we're in the love of Yahshua, making a difference how we do that. Read.
And others save with fear.
Yes.
Pulling them out of the fire.
Right there. Right there. We pull them out of the fire by the gospel. So they're not thinking about the old satanic ways of worship. Praying in the Holy Spirit. Pulling them out of the fire. We say there's going to be hell, fire, in the grave. We're in that judgment now. You follow? We're in the end time now to bring them out of the end and into a conscience of their creator. That's what we do here. In with the love in Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading now.
Hating even the garment.
Even the garment. It does make a matter if you're going to say Jesus or some other erroneous thing. It does matter. Hating the garment of wickedness, of unrighteousness. That's what we hate. Not the person, but what they're clothed in, what they understand about their Savior. That's what we hate. Keep reading. I'll be right done. My time is expired.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless.
We present you faultless based off of the gospel of Yahshua. It's not my story.
That's right.
I would have given the rest ass to have to be down here all as much time as I'm down here. But I have a love for the people in order to pull them out of the fire. They don't understand me. But they know Star Wars, they can't do nothing with me. Because I stand on the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading. Huh? What does it say?
Before the presence of his glory.
That's right. That's all I got to do. We're in front of his glory. And I'm not ashamed of him. Huh? As John says over there in Romans 1:16. I'm no longer afraid to preach the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. That's another story. Keep reading.
With exceeding joy.
I have great joy.
To the only wise
Elohim. To the Elohim, only wise Elohim.
Our Savior.
Our Savior.
And Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign.
Yeah.
Belong glory and majesty.
Yes.
Dominion and power.
Yes.
Both now and forever.
Hallelujah. Got anything out of today's class? All praises to Yahweh, our Elohim, by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What's up?
This concludes this afternoon lecture. Do we have any announcement? We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring your enemies and friends. This is the place to learn about our Heavenly Father. Let's all stand and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him
that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and forever. Let the class say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Great class. Enjoy the rest of the evening, everyone.
You too, Hartens. Take care. Peace in Yahshua.